Hello, and welcome to Signal X JW3, Heroes and Villains, the Purim edition. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Adam Lenson. And very briefly, I am a director and producer based in London that produces lots of new musical theatre concerts and events. And this is our second collaboration with JW3, the UK's biggest and best Jewish arts and community centre. And yeah, what we've got for you tonight is some incredible new musical theatre from all over the country and the world, coming to you live. So a bit of a logistical operation going on backstage, but it's all intended so that we can all be together with you live, in some sense. Yeah, Purim is normally, for me, a time where people are having a big party and singing and dancing and being together and their voices being in collective unison, retelling stories and celebrating and the things that need celebrating and booing the things that need booing. But yes, we can't do that this year. So we're trying to make something of that instead and bring you songs and stories and artists and people. And we're so glad you're with us. And we're so glad we have a way of celebrating Purim with you and with this amazing new musical theatre. Anyway, without further ado, I am going to take you live to a different part of London and to JW3's Deborah Vogt.
Hello. Thank you so much, Adam, and hello, everybody. Right, as Adam said, I'm the performance programmer at JW3, and for those of you who don't know JW3, we're the biggest Jewish cultural center in the UK with a big variety of classes, conversations, and events. Over the past year, the majority of these events have gone online while our physical building transformed into a food bank that continues to fight food poverty in Camden. But meanwhile, our cultural events are online. And if you are a fan of musical tie-ins to Jewish festivals, which I get is pretty niche, but you're here, I just want to highlight an exciting upcoming event in March. In the lead up to Pesach, the Jewish Festival of Freedom, Billy Bragg will be in conversation with Raphael Zarum to discuss what it means to be free. And this event is on March 18th, and you can find out more information on our website. But tonight, we're celebrating something else. One of the things that I love about JW3 events is that our audiences connect Jewish and non-Jewish people, as well as Jews of all backgrounds. And I'm aware that there may be some people watching right now that don't know much about Purim. So I'm just going to give you a very short, very concise story of Purim to contextualize some of this event. And to accompany me in this is the brilliant Emily Rose Simons. All right, are you ready, Emily? I hope so. So let's go. Purim is the celebration of Queen Esther and how she miraculously saved the Jewish people. Esther, a humble Jewish girl, caught the eye of the king, who had just sentenced his previous wife to death for not following his orders, which, by the way, were to parade naked in front of his dinner party. And in some children's books, this is depicted as not wanting to get naked because of having donkey ears and a tail, as if she needed a reason. Anyway, so Esther became his new queen. Esther did not reveal her nationality to the king at this time because the king's advisor, Haman, hated the Jewish people and sought the death of Esther's cousin Mordecai. Haman was angry that Mordecai refused to bow down to him and convinced the king to issue an extermination order against the Jews. Mordecai convinced all of the Jews to repent, fast, and pray, while Esther asked the king to join her for a feast. Approaching the king without being summoned was not allowed, and if the king had been unhappy with Esther for doing this, she could have been killed. With great faith, Esther revealed her Jewish heritage to the king during the feast and pleaded with the king to stop Haman's plans. The king listened to Esther, and instead of killing her, he had Haman killed and issued a new decree, allowing the Jews the right to defend themselves. The end. Thank you, Emily. Of course, there wasn't the end. The story continues, but read on elsewhere because we have a party to start. All right. I am so excited. Thank you so much to Adam, Emily, every single performer tonight, and thank you to the audience for being here. Enjoy the show.
Thanks, Deborah, and thank you, Emily, for underscoring that live, which is a new thing. And for those of you who don't know about Purim involves the retelling of the story of Esther, and when the name of the bad guy, Haman, we said Haman, but Americans all seem to say Haman, is mentioned, people would make noise communally, collectively. So I just want to also empower you to take tonight as a way of celebrating and drinking, and you know, if you've got noisemakers, you can make noise. We won't hear it, but your neighbors might hear it. And it's an opportunity to, make a collective noise for the things that we care about. One of the things that I obviously care about, as well as Judaism, is musical theater. And we've been running these concerts for now since 2017. And like tonight's lineup is Jewish, or Jewish-ish, is an extraordinary lineup of composers and lyricists and songwriters. And I think the best thing to do is to go on with the show. So I'm going to bring in our first composer lyricist, our first songwriter, and they may be familiar to you from a couple of minutes ago. It is the brilliant Emily Rose Simons. Hi, Emily. How you doing?
Hi. Hello. Happy Purim. I've taken my Valentine's Day decorations and made them Purim-esque.
Thank you.
Yay.
Well, thank you for joining the celebration. And
thank you for having
I was saying
me.
Normally at Signal, I leave the writer on their own to talk, but today we're going into more of an interview mode so we can be together, which is nice. Just tell us a little bit about yourself and your writing, if you can.
Sure. Okay, a little bit about myself and my writing. I am a musical theatre writer, and I live in Northwest London, and I'm Jewish. And those answers, were those words? Is that the kind of way that we say things?
And, cool. And your shows, you know, I've noticed that some of your shows kind of intersect with themes of Judaism.
Yes, definitely. So coming this summer, very excitingly, a little bit of a plug, Tanya Truman is producing and performing Confessions of a Rabbi's Daughter, which I performed at JW3 a couple of years ago, and that it was the first musical I ever wrote, I went straight for the Jewish themes for my first musical, and I'm very excited to be able to watch someone else perform it. So that's coming this summer. That's very exciting. And then also with the piece that I have a song from tonight, The Repatriate, the main character of that musical is Jewish. It had its beginnings as part of JW3's Scratch. Everything feels like a couple of years ago, honestly. Who knows?
A million years ago.
Yeah.
How are you going to be celebrating Purim?
This. Actually, I was talking to Tanya earlier because I went to the Marks and Spencer's in Temple Fortune to get my Purim gin, and I was talking to Tanya. She's like, "Yes, Evan saw you getting some gin in Temple Fortune." Her boyfriend Evan, who also is the animator for something that Powell has.
Wilf Goes Wild. Yeah.
Yes, but he saw my Purim gin, and I also got some Hamantaschen, obviously from Daniel's. I found it very steadily of you get your Purim gin, someone saw you, hear from someone else that you got, it's very cute.
Oh, that's lovely to hear. People seeing each other in person, even from a distance, is kind of lovely at this time. Fantastic. Well, set up the song for us and tell us about the singer.
So the song is called Cautiously Happy. It's sung by Natasha Karp, who has been our Amy from the beginning of this piece, pretty much. And it's been incredible developing it with such a wonderful human and also extremely talented actress and performer. And it's been amazing. She's great. The song itself is kind of very Purim-y in a weird way. So the show is about a woman who can't get out of bed. She lost her visa. She's her life she made this amazing life for herself and it all fell apart very suddenly and she can't get out of bed, is the main premise of the show. But in the show, in the telling of the show, we go back and forth into her life before that. And this is the moment where everything feels like it's going extremely right for her. And she's scared to accept that good things are happening because in her life she's learned that like bad things happen all the time. Like she shouldn't trust that people want to help her. She shouldn't trust this, but she wants to trust that good things are happening. And for the audience view, we know that after this moment, things are going to hit the fan and she is going to end up losing her job and her visa and ending up in bed for weeks on end. But in this moment, we get to enjoy and be happy for her, which is very much, if I get a little bit madrashy on it, but like, Purim is, all of our festivals seem to be like, and we didn't die, but this one is the one where like, we're gonna get really drunk because we didn't die. And even though we know, like, we know history, we know bad things happen, we know that things don't always turn out and there will be more horrendous things, we take this moment to drink until we can't see good from evil. But I think it's like we can't see what is good and what is bad, like what's coming towards us. We just take this moment to just accept that this is a win, this is a good thing. But yes, those are words. Yes,
thank you so much. Here you go, Natasha Karp. Thanks, Natasha. Oh, I just had a little moment.
So hard it's hard to breathe. Breathing somehow makes me sweat. What's this eruption? What is this shaking? Why does my face burn? Is my brain trembling? Or racing round in circles? I'm getting sick. Am I getting sick? My temperature's fine, so why am I so gross? What is this feeling? What is this feeling? It's almost as if I feel cautiously not empty, cautiously feel something, cautiously want, cautiously need, cautiously hope tomorrow won't sting. Can I cautiously act on emotions I might one day need to rescind? Can I cautiously throw caution to the wind? Health's so hard, it's hard to breathe. What will happen if I do? Can I afford to relax? Can I afford to pretend that everyone won't always fall through? Maybe life is joking, 'cause the universe hates me. It's just another trap, it's just another game to distract from my priority. So I cannot be feeling, I need not to be feeling. I'm not stupid enough to allow myself to be cautiously not depressed, cautiously feel, I don't know, cautiously unwrap a life-changing gift that's really a bomb about to blow. Or can I cautiously act on emotions with the chance I might not have to rescind? Can I cautiously throw caution to the wind? There is evidence and precedence and beta tests and data to indicate that none of this is have a fact-based history that trust is a bad investment. So I shouldn't trust what's in front of me. I shouldn't. Shit. Or it's not a sin for me to smile. No, excitement's not my thing. Hope is not for me. Blue skies have never been my style. But everything's aligning. The sun is in full sight. Everything seems perfect and might stay perfect even when the day turns into night. I should.
Thank you so much, Natasha. What an amazing way to kick us off. What an incredible song. You may notice that I always get the sides mixed up. Next to me are the comments from our YouTube chat. I know that there are people watching both on YouTube and on Facebook. If you're on YouTube, your comments will appear here. I keep getting it wrong. So comment along, make some friends, boo, applaud, drink, emojis, whatever you want. You can also tweet along at hashtag SignalXJW3. We have got some incredible artists today coming up, an amazing array of artists, and like, you know, without wanting to pick any names out of this ridiculous lineup, the literal creator of Transparent, Joey Soloway, and their sister Faith Soloway are joining us later, along with a writer of a little known musical called Six, Toby, Marlow. So there's some reasons to stick around, and there are some reasons to tell people you're watching and get them to join us too, because we're going to have a really, really fun night together. Straight on to our next writer. I'm so thrilled that he's able to join us all the way from Pittsburgh. I met him when he was in London. He might be moving back to London again soon. And I always tell him that he was like a fixture of early lockdown one when I binge watched the entirety of Encore on Disney Plus, in which he was the musical director. Bringing you now Adam Wachter.
Here?
Oh my God. You're here. I'm like, because I'm tracking it too, and like my hand gets
God.
So my hand was
you're
like
a one
on
man band.
I know, oh. I'm stressed. Anyway,
you're doing it all. It's amazing.
How are you, Adam?
I'm great. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good.
Happy Purim.
Happy Purim. It's lovely to be here with you. When we spoke in the soundcheck earlier, you had a great Purim dressing up story, so I thought I'd
ask you
about that.
Yeah, I have to show you. So this is me outside the costume, but I would get into that sort of clock. Oh, you can see the ring light. I don't know if you could see it. Yeah, so I grew up in this little town in Michigan where there were no Jews, but except us. So we would drive like over an hour every weekend to go to synagogue and things. And so Purim was always an exciting time because there was a costume competition. And at that age, like any excuse to get dressed up or win something or perform in any way, you know, was a huge deal for me. And that was my costume one year. It was actually a recycled Halloween costume. It was like this grandfather clock made out of a cardboard box. But then for Purim, we just stuck a sign on it that said something like, "The Jews, you know, made it just in time," or some, I don't even know, but some like weird to try to tie it to Purim. Anyway,
I think it's good to be able to have a place to reuse our Halloween costumes so they get used twice a year. That's kind of
I know exactly. Sense. That's is that all Purim's good for? No, but that's one great that's one great perk of celebrating it, I guess.
Fantastic. Tell us about the song you're going to sing for us.
Yeah, I'm going to sing this song called "The End of the Line." It's not from anything. I wrote it on spec for a project and it never got used, and so now I have it. And when you said heroes and villains, I thought of it because it's just this song about sort of at the end of your life looking back on what you accomplished and you know, being proud of the things you did and focusing on the big, exciting, worthwhile things you did and not all the little things that maybe went wrong along the way. So yeah, I'm gonna sing it. Should I go? I'm gonna sing.
And wait a second, I just realized I have to like turn the camera so it's only on you, because you don't want me here the whole time.
I would love to see your reaction, just clapping and
exactly. Take it away. Have fun.
All right, here we go. Can you hear this piano? Good. All right, here we go. At the end of the line, when you run out of track, it's the very last stop on your journey. Past the last exit sign, when you finally look back, look around and recall it all the triumphs, the goals you met. What's it all about? Add it up and see what you get. Did you have it figured out? At the end of the day, at the end of the road, every hurdle you jump leaves a footprint. As you went on your way, every seed that you sowed might eventually sprout and bloom. Each idea you threw aside, each song left unsung. Best make sure that you're satisfied when your final bell has rung. Petty problems that caused you stress when you're gone couldn't matter less. All that meaningless woe gets left behind, 'cause it's only the big stuff that really counts when it's the end of the line. Each idea you threw aside, each song left unsung. Best make sure that you're satisfied when your final bell has rung. When your final bell has rung. Petty problems that caused you stress when you're gone couldn't matter less. All that meaningless woe gets left behind, 'cause it's only the big stuff that really counts when it's the end of the line.
Thank you so much, Adam. From Adam to Adam, that was like, I did the transition there and we like melted through one another. It was cool. From opposite sides of the world. Awesome. So we have been in Golders Green, and then we went to Pittsburgh, and now we're going back to London, various different parts of North and South London now. And I'm really excited about the next show because it is... it's a pretty Jewish show, and this writer I was lucky enough to work with on the Offie Award-winning Superhero, and is just brilliant, and taking you now to meet Joseph Finlay. Hey, Joseph.
Hi.
Oh my God! Excellent hat game and wallpaper.
Gotta have a hat. Purim, obviously.
No. I feel like I spent most of my life wearing hats, and my hair is a lockdown mess, but I just didn't find the right one in time. But I'm it's great. So you've written a pretty Jewish show, or you're on the way to writing a pretty Jewish show. You finished writing the song like yesterday, as I understand.
Yeah, pretty doesn't really cover it. It's really super Jewish, and it's in progress. We have a script, and we're working on songs. It's called A Rabbi of Many Principles, about the unlikely rise to fame of the somewhat uncharismatic Rabbi Nathan Lukunowitz, and it's set in a slightly imagined version of the British Jewish community. So we are talking about the role of supreme rabbi, but that may or may not have similarities to other jobs you may have heard of.
And how are you celebrating Purim?
Limited way. I will definitely be dressing my daughter up, and we'll try and attend some kind of my toddler online thing. But I'm a great fan of Purim ever since my days of gap year in Jerusalem, in drag, going around crashing yeshiva parties and getting thrown out because I was so convincing. So I'm a big Purim fan. So whatever I can do to make it a live, I will.
Fantastic. Can you set up the song for us?
Yes. So this song is in the classic musical theatre setting of a rabbinical appointments committee. You know, it's almost cliche, isn't it? So many of these songs. And our singer is the chair, Dinky Kaplan, who is the chair of the committee, who is, and she will be trying to convince the committee to move from their previously settled position on who to appoint the Supreme Rabbi in a different direction. And we'll see how convincing she will turn out to be.
Fantastic. And singing this live is the amazing Julie Clare. Here we go to Julie. Thanks, Joseph.
Is it the unanimous view of this committee that we nominate Rabbi Louis Green to the role of Supreme Rabbi of the United Kingdom? Aubrey? Harold? Monty? Doreen? All in favour of Louis? Noted. In that case, I feel I ought to say three important words. Not so fast. Yes, Doreen. I know Louis is well liked. Yes, yes, I also saw him on Good Morning Britain on his yoga mat. Yes, Aubrey? I know he's popular with the youth, but so were yo-yos. Popular doesn't mean integrity. Yes, Harold. Popular with the youth? Aubrey just said that? He did, Harold. Check the minutes. Oh. What do you mean, what am I trying to say? I'm saying it. I don't trust Rabbi Louis Green. And I don't think you should either. Louis Green, the finest rabbi that we've seen. But what you see and what you get are very different things. Louis speaks and wins the crowd. Anglo-Jewry feels so proud. But Louis Green is a hidden threat. He's superficial, clinical, and very unrabbinical. A rabbi's not a Jew without a neshama, an empty vessel who has zero Jewish soul. A show-off and a maverick will never see us through. Rabbi Louis Green is not a Jewish Jew. Louis is a big risk. Remember when we took a risk on Rabbi Balagansky? We had to send him back to San Francisco, didn't we? Yes. Do you remember, Audrey? Short man with a ponytail? Yes, I know he was acquitted, but that's not the point. The point is that Louis will leave us in the exact same mess. And at the International Interfaith Climate Change Assembly, with the vegans and the Christians and the Hindus up in Wembley. Louis shared a platform with a Muslim delegation and said nothing when they chose to mention Israel's occupation. Shush! I haven't finished! On desert island discs where you only have 8 choices, he chose a piece in Yiddish by a group called Leftist Voices. And Louis has a brother who's a well-known Scientologist, and a cousin who's on Twitter as a Corbynite apologist. No, Aubrey, I still haven't finished. If we take on Louis Green, it's a world of endless scandals, not to mention jeans and tambourines and yoga mats and sandals. Multicultural seder serving lentil tofu brisket. The point I'm trying to make is, do we really want to risk it? I'd like to propose an alternative candidate, Rabbi Nathan Lakunovitz. Calm down. No, Aubrey, you can't have a point of order. I have the floor. No, Aubrey, I have the floor. I hereby officially nominate Rabbi Nathan Lakunovitz to the role of Supreme Rabbi. You have your doubts, I understand. Nathan isn't bold or grand. He's introverted, or some may say incompetent. But Nathan has a heart so pure, so even if he seems unsure, we'll guide him as he walks his way. He's an upright moral giant, and he's also quite compliant. A rabbi is not a Jew without a neshama, and Nathan, I tell you, has the greatest Jewish heart. This quiet little nebbish might just see us through. Rabbi Nathan Lakunovitz is a very, very, very Jewish Jew. Who will vote in favor of Nathan? Harold? Monty? Doreen? Thank you, Doreen. I knew we could count on you. No, Aubrey. Now is not the time for a point of order. Now is the time to vote. Aubrey. Aubrey. Aubrey! Thank you, Aubrey. Then we are all in favor. Nathan Lakunovitz will be our next Supreme Rabbi. A rabbi's not a Jew without a neshama, and Nathan, I tell you, has the greatest Jewish heart. This peculiar little man is the one to see us through. He's the prayer we say on waking. He's the smell of challah baking. He's the glow of candlelight on a Hamish Friday night, as Abraham obeyed the Lord and went to kill his son. Nathan will obey us when we need to get things done. Nathan Lakunovitz is a very, very Jewish Jew.
Thank you so much, Julie. That was incredible. I should also say that because that song is brand new, Julie learnt it mostly in the last 24 hours. But yeah, thank you, Julie. And I love the sort of vaguely Jackie Weaver vibes of that kind of like small town bureaucracy, and amazing, amazing work by Joseph Finlay and Rafe Smith there. Okay. So obviously this has been a weird, cloudy time, marked by distance, but one of the amazing things about it has been getting to meet new people and new writers who I didn't know before, that I've exclusively got to know through this time. And our next writer is one of those. And I didn't know that she was Jewish until I saw a Facebook post by her that was, I think, something to do with Tu B'Shvat or something quite Jewish. And I remember thinking, oh, I guess she is. She's in Brooklyn right now, coming to you live, but is originally from Australia. So that is some brilliant geography that we're bringing in tonight. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce Anna K. Jacobs. Here we go.
Hi.
Hey, Anna.
Hi, Adam. Hi. Hi, everybody in England and elsewhere.
How are you doing?
I am doing pretty good, all things considered. Thank you.
Yeah.
It's great to be in the company of all these great artists tonight.
Oh, yeah, it's nice, isn't it? It kind of makes you feel, and you know, the hectic nature of the backstage almost makes you feel like you're doing an in-person show.
Yeah, I feel like I'm really, really in a green room.
Exactly. A digital green room full of people running like headless chickens trying to figure it out. But hopefully that gives everyone a great live experience. Yeah, you were telling me just when we were doing sound check that you were like, you were Jewish-ish and that you like...
I'm Jewish.
Yeah, do you want to tell us about that?
Oh, sure. Yeah, so my dad is the one who is the Jew in the family, and my mother never converted. And so we were sort of, my three brothers and sisters and I were raised with some Judaism and some Christianity, and it was sort of all up for grabs. But then when I was about, I guess, 20 or 21, the Temple Emmanuel in Sydney, Australia, where my father's family went for a long time, they needed a soprano in their professional quartet, and they hired me. And so I would be there every Saturday morning singing in the services. I observed many a bar mitzvah in my time. And that's sort of how I got to reconnect with that history.
That is awesome. How are you celebrating Purim?
Well, my five-year-old made a knight's outfit using cardboard boxes and an egg carton, and he made a helmet from a plastic milk bottle, I might try it on later.
That's amazing. Set up the song for us. It's an amazing song.
Thank you. I would not say it's necessarily in the spirit of Purim. It's a bit serious, but that's sort of where I enjoy living as a musical theater writer. And you mentioned the hero and the villain theme. And this is a song from a musical I wrote called Any Town for the George Street Playhouse over here in the US. And they had commissioned it in response to the opioid epidemic that has especially been impacting teens in the country. This song from the show is written for the character Joey. He's a high school student, a senior in high school, and his friend has become addicted to OxyContin. And he makes this discovery, and he sort of left in this position where he has to decide what to do. And the reason it's kind of, I thought of this song tonight, is that you go into the song thinking that he's going to step up and be a hero, and something happens that I won't talk about, because you'll see for yourself. It's being performed tonight by Joe Pizzocchio, who's the beautiful young actor who actually originated the role. It was such a joy being able to write this for him.
Thank you so much. All right, here we go to Joe. Thanks so much, Anna.
My first ever day of middle school, I was sitting alone in the cafeteria, picking at my chicken parmesan and gritting my teeth to hold back the tears. The new kids, they deemed me a loser, 'cause I met all the typical nerd criteria. So my old friends kept their distance and acted as if they didn't know me, even though they know me for years. But then she walked in like she owned the place, with that trademark smile lighting up her face, and she plopped down beside me and you do for a friend. unrecognizably, cause she's turned into something completely savage. There's a monster inside of her body, and it's learned from her duper poor mom and me. It gets what it wants when it wants it. So good luck if you try to escape its ravage. But the messes it's making and the secrets it's hiding will come back and bite her in the ass eventually. She could get expelled and destroy her dreams. She could overdose if this thing's bad as it seems. It's my duty to keep her from falling apart at the seams. Cause that's what you do for a friend. Where would that leave me? If it weren't for us, I don't know who I would be. So I'll turn a blind eye to the danger and the doubt, and trust she'll work things out and pull through. Cause I don't know what I'd do without my one and only.
Thank you so much, Joe, and thank you so much, Anna. Wow, what an incredible song and an incredible performance. Our next writer is he was in London, then he moved to New York, then he was in Israel, now he's back in London, and he's sort of done signals from all three locations. He's a brilliant writer and a mainstay of the Signal family, and it gives me great pleasure. And also, I should say, as I'm looking at the preview, has gone to town on the Purim theme. So it gives me great pleasure to take you now to Amir Shoenfeld. Hi, Amir.
Yes. Hello. Hi. How's it going?
Yeah, it's really good. Thank you. Tell us about your costume.
Well, it's relevant to the song I'm going to sing. I've procured this wig couple of days ago. This is a jumper that I bought my partner for Christmas, but now I'm considering just repatriating it to myself.
I think you look great in it.
Thanks.
What does Purim mean to you?
Well, you know, like, I grew up in Israel, so growing up in Israel we don't have Halloween. So Purim is all we get. So growing up, I was very, very excited about it. And I was one of those kids who, you know, plans the costume months in advance and puts a lot of effort into it. And there was something about the, you know, the obligatory military service that I think took it out of me. I'd rather wear my own clothes. But being in London is really nice to kind of be able to feel the Purim spirit. And especially during COVID, feeling any kind of sense of community spirit is priceless.
Yeah, Yeah, it's I remember the last time I was at Synagogue for Purim, which must have been 2 years ago now, and it was like Fiddler on the Roof themed, and there were like bales of hay and people were playing the violin and dancing around, and it seems like another world now, but this is bringing back the memories in some small
way. There was a year in my school where a group of boys decided to dress up as a farm, and they got a couple of sheep and a bunch of bales of hay, and they had, you know, like the pitchforks and everything, and they just kind of stood around school, and they had like a whole section. It was like, you know, like a room for themselves, just as being the farm.
That's pretty special.
I've gone to a cool school.
So set up the song you're about to sing for us.
Right, so it's a standalone song that I wrote kind of inspired by a news story that I read last year. It's based on true events, and it's about this woman called Aya Gomez Yanis, who at the time was 79 and had been the most senior flight attendant in the West Coast of America. She was a flight attendant for 57 years, and then she got fired. And the airline kind of quoted some really flimsy excuses. They said that she stole some milk and cereal from the plane. Didn't make much sense. There's a lot of evidence that she was an exemplary employee, and she sued them. And I read about this and I watched some interviews with her. She's such an interesting character. I've sort of taken some creative license with writing the song, and she doesn't quite look the way I'm dressed, but you should look up interviews with her. She's a bit of a boss, and she's quite a character taking on this big corporate airline, suing them for unlawful dismissal and age discrimination. Oh.
Yes, she sounds like a hero, and I can't wait to hear the song. All right, I'll leave you to it. Thanks so much, Amir.
In 1962, I felt in luck to have a job. Back then a girl could hardly hope for more. An income, independence, and I got to see the world. From Nashville, Tennessee to Singapore. So I decided then I'd never tread on any toes. I'd never make a scene or cause a fuss. Young women in my day were not expected to speak up, and so we let them walk all over us. After 57 years, it suddenly appears my quiet little mass routine has run its course. And though the situation will lead to confrontation, they have to let me back into the labor force. And if 57 years have taught me anything, I'm not a quitter. I won't lay down and die. I'll fight for what's right and fair. I'm a heavy hitter. I'll raise a hue and cry until I'm back at 30,000 feet in the air. My pre-flight safety demonstration's always been precise. I never took a sick day, no, not me. To put me out to pasture like this isn't very nice. If they think I'm too old, I disagree. And so whatever they imply, a new day starts for Ida. No more nice old lady, now I'm standing pat. This golden girl crusader, they'll have to reinstate her. I'm going back, so go put out the welcome mat. Cause the 57 years have taught me anything. I'm not a quitter. I won't lay down and die. I'll fight for what's right and fair. Flying is over. The future is a little unclear. But if I'm gonna be defiant and take on the corporate giant, it's because I know that I can persevere. I'll persevere. Cause I'm not a quitter. I'm certain, strong, and spry. I'll fight for what's right and fair. I'm a heavy hitter. Go away your table, check your seat backs fully upright, and your mo-
Thank you so much. What a bop. Amir Shoenfeld really does write anthemic bops. And yeah, I'll be humming that all night. And thank you for getting into the spirit, Amir. We appreciate it. Fantastic. All right, on we go. Our next writer is a Signal first timer. And really pleased to welcome him. He's a writer I've known about for a while, and was delighted to hear that he was Jewish. Not that I only like Jewish writers, but it helps when you're organizing a musical theatre night for JW3. It gives me great pleasure to introduce everybody. Wait a second. I just suddenly realized that he doesn't look like he's ready. I'm just gonna riff for a bit. 1 second. I don't really know what to do here. I'm just gonna see if the people in the green room know what's going on. Oh, there he is. Okay. Often I have a habit of when I maybe this is now is a good moment in the evening to just say you know, a little bit like people would bang a saucepan, if anyone wants to make 10 seconds of righteous noise while also toasting a drink, now could be a good time to do that. I'm just gonna breathe deeply. We've got 5 more incredible writers coming up, and okay. And the writer, it looks like he's back. I can see him in the program view. He's sort of like disappeared, which is not ideal, but I can see him settling back into his seat. Anyway, the writers that we've got coming up next are amazing. We have Julian Hornik, we have Toby Marlow, we have Joey and Faith Soloway. But before that, we have our next writer. I see him putting on his headphones. You know, the amount of tech wizardry that's going on behind the scenes, sometimes it doesn't. Okay, oh my God. Okay. Do you know what? I'm just gonna. Yeah. Okay. Just hold. What's going on? I have his, yeah, okay. Okay, we're gonna go to the next composer's video because he didn't come, and maybe we'll get him to talk afterwards. Okay, here's Alexander Espermange.
I may have desired someday sharing with you my home and my life, and if pushed, chocolates too. To see all you say, show in all that you do, and know you'll commit more than sins. I may have desired you'd retain all I said, or dare to make plans over 2 weeks ahead, to not see one signal that I'd been misled, and know all your passwords and pins. But dreams once so clear have turned to a blur, for all those desires aren't at all as they were. And today your future is past, my feelings are frozen somehow. Each dream and design linked your life to mine, but not now. I may have been too much in love all these years, not paid enough heed to forebodings and fears. Thought marriage and motherhood are worth a few tears, spent all of my future on you. I may have naively held out for the day you'd readily make a commitment to stay, and there'd be no kindness you wouldn't repay, or heartaches I'd keep blundering through. But now all at once it's crushingly clear that is a day that won't ever appear. Every sign that I must have missed makes me feel at fault, I avow. I wish wished you to be forever with me, but not now. Maybe it came to be my one sure aspiration to be your sole temptation and distraction and aim. Now I finally see that with patience and kindness come delusion and blindness. I cannot escape blame. I may have desired all the love I could get with church bells and babies or simply a pet, and signs of each sacrifice not made as yet would hold hesitation and doubt. I may have desired all the time we could share, I'd feel certain comfort from having you there, and find all your foibles less frightening to bear, and trust in old flames dying out. But all of those dreams are so far away, and seem the desires of a stranger today. It's a love one beat out of time, a move that both hearts must allow. And though I may doubt the conviction I've got, and each fresh resolve that should follow might not, my dreams always centered on you. I lived for just one to come true, but not now.
Thank you so much to Charlotte Steen for that amazing performance of that beautiful song by Alexander S. Bermange. Sorry that we didn't get to Alexander before the song, but we're just going to say hi to him now. And with the out of orderness is very Purim. So hi, Alexander, how are you doing?
Hello, I'm all right, thank you. Yes, it's all deliberate, isn't it? Everything's deliberate.
Keeps us on our toes. And I also, you know, I always like people to know that this is a live evening, that we didn't just pre-record this all and just press play at the beginning. There's some danger and some tension.
Yeah, that's exactly why we did it, to prove it's live. I'm good, thank you. How are you? Lovely to be here.
Tell us about that beautiful song we just heard. Wow.
Oh, bless your heart. Well, many thanks, as you say, to Charlotte and Steen for performing it so wonderfully. It's from a musical that I've been collaborating on with book writer Simon Warne, which is based on Carol Matthews's best-selling novel, The Chocolate Lovers Club. And the number that we just heard is performed by the heroine of our show, on the subject of heroes and villains, Lucy Lombard, shortly after she discovers that her long-standing boyfriend has rather villainously been cheating on her.
Amazing, and thank you for finding the theme of heroes and villains. It's a good opportunity to say sorry,
I was just going to say, you see, with me, when I hear the word heroes, it conjures up one very clear image in my mind, which is one of a big, seductive, indispensable blue tub consisting of miniature chocolate bars, collectively known as Cadbury Heroes. Then again, I am somewhat of a chocoholic, hence being entranced by the Chocolate Lovers Club, the novel, and wanting to musicalise it.
Yeah, the Cadbury's Heroes are a good Purim treat.
The chocolate as we know it was invented by Jewish refugees fleeing the Portuguese Inquisition in France?
I didn't know that, but I'm glad.
Did you know that? There we are. The introduction of the Inquisition in Portugal in 1536. Some Jews fled to France, settling across the border, were allowed to live in France as so-called new Christians, and restricting then their ability to travel and to own land and to trade. One industry was open to them, which was relying on contacts with other Jews and secret Jews in the New World. The French community imported cocoa and processed early chocolate treats. So there we are. You've got the Jews to thank for chocolate.
Even more reason to have Hamantaschen and chocolate on Thursday.
Absolutely. I should say so.
Also, just to say, these videos, all of the signals stay up forever. So you can watch this interview and then go back and watch the song. And that is absolutely fine. Thank you so much for joining us, Alexander. And
thanks very much for having me. Lovely to be here.
Thank you. See you soon. All right. So we figured it out and we carry on. So our next pair of writers are also beloved Signal stalwarts. They agreed to do the concert and then were unfortunately unable to join us live due to various circumstances beyond the control of a live broadcast. But they were, when faced with the theme of heroism, it suddenly became apparent that the three of us had all recently just been involved in a show about the fact that everyone right now is enacting daily acts of heroism and survival in this challenging and difficult time. The writers are Francesca Forristal and Jordan Paul Clarke, who are amazing. And some of you may have heard of them because they wrote and performed in a show called Public Domain, which was produced in a live stream production by Southwark Playhouse and me in January. And little plug, is still available on demand for the next 5 days at Southwark Playhouse. So if you like what you're about to see, which is a song from Public Domain, then you can watch it for 5 more days. And there's going to be an album coming out soon, and it's a whole thing. Anyway, it's a verbatim show about the internet, those who own it, those who live in it, and you. And this is the last song that they wrote for it. And it's verbatim, and it's made entirely out of Instagram posts and tweets. And the provocation was, the thing that they started looking for to try and assemble a collage of tweets was, does anyone else just and to see what came up. And that was the kind of instigator for a song about resilience and everyday heroism. It's called Rise and Conquer, and here is an extract of it from our live streamed production of Public Domain. So enjoy.
Hi guys, and welcome back to my channel. So I've got a bit of a different video for you today. So if you don't know, I have my own podcast called The Rise and Conquer Podcast. And honestly, I talk about everything on there. I really want to be an empowering voice, not just surface level things. And honestly, I talk about everything on there. A lot of us are just feeling broken down, because we had these goals and now they're not happening. Now they're not happening. Maybe it's just me. Does anyone else feel absolutely nothing? It can't just be me, but it feels like it. Does anyone feel alone sometimes? Even though you have people all around you, it can't just be me, but it feels like it could be. A lot of us are just feeling broken down, because we had these goals and now they're not standing. First lockdown was a blessing, with the sun shining, and now it's dark at 4 o'clock and a lonely world. Does anyone else just sit on their shower floor when you shower instead of standing, because you don't feel like sun shining, but now it's dark at 4 o'clock, and alone he
Thank you so much, in absence to Francesca Forristal and Jordan Paul Clarke. Oh, that song is such an anthem for these times, but really inspires you to get up and do something and celebrate and find community. And just to say also, the video overlays for that song were edited by the incredible Matt Powell, and that was overlaid onto a live performance stream from Southwark Playhouse, which you can still watch for 5 more days. I would say check it out if you can, and you can watch it anywhere in the world anytime. Okay, we're on to our final three. I can't believe how quickly this evening has gone. It's been a brilliant party, and the three writers we've got next are just, well, the three writers writing teams we've got are just amazing. So I cannot wait to hear their songs. I cannot wait for you to hear their songs. The next writer was at our very first Signal back in 2017, and I love it when they come back to perform songs with us, because it's lovely to, their work has been seen on massive stages and to celebrate it, rightly so, with huge acclaim. But there's something really special about seeing them at a piano just singing, and that's what we're about to see with a song that was finished this evening. So it gives me great pleasure. Oh, I just realized something, and it's gonna just take me 1 second to clear up, and because I'm stupid. So just stick with me for a second. So you should know that while the concert is happening, I'm also programming and queuing everything, and we do it all on the day, and I'm on a queuing program right now. And I realized I had messed up a queue, and I'm just building it now. So that's kind of like a fun thing. And we're ready. So here we go to meet the incredible, the esteemed, the spectacular Toby Marlow. Hey, Toby.
Hi, how's it going?
I never built a queue with us side by side. And I was like, how are we going to talk if there's no queue? So I just had to make one. But
am I meant to be seeing you? Because I can't see you.
No, we're on a kind of... The audiences can see us both, but we can just hear each other. So that's
okay. I love that, because I've seen you on the stream and it all looks great. Hi, how's it going?
It's going well. How are you celebrating this Purim? With an amazing top, by the look of it.
Oh, with an amazing new top. Yes, thank you so much. Oh, and also my Jewish earrings. A little star David's, yeah. So that's why I'm celebrating. This is my first ever time celebrating for him. Because even though I am Jewish, I wasn't raised Jewish, and it's only really been like the last year or so that I've been trying to get in touch with my roots. And so I can't think of a better way to spend it than watching this amazing concert, which I've loved every single second of so far. So that's great.
Aww.
Love a signal.
We've been glad to have you. And I always say that, Judaism is more about art and community than it is about anything else. And that's why I love evenings like Tonight, because being together and sharing art is so special to me.
Yeah, I would agree.
Why don't you tell us about the song that you finished writing this evening?
So this is it's a song that I kind of bashed out in the last week, couple of weeks or so, and I have no idea what it's going to be for yet, but it's something. It's poppy in style, and then I added a little middle eight bridge section, especially for this evening, because it was unfinished, and I was like, oh, well, there's a very kind of like heroes and villains message theme to it, as you'll hear, that it's about kind of like, you know, putting big middle fingers up to the villains in your life and being your own hero, is what I would say.
Thank you.
So.
All right, well, I'm excited to hear it. I know everyone else will be too, so I'll let you take it away.
Fab, thanks.
Thanks, Toby.
Slip my headphones off. Okay. Cool. Living in a world where the world didn't fit me, I was out of place. They would do their worst with their words just to hurt me every single day. And though I didn't care what they'd all say about me, I would let it get me down. Everything they'd send would send me into a frenzy. I'd run and hide away. But I've been growing now. I know when everything you say gets in my head, fuck it all, baby. Throw it all at me. Do your worst, baby. Fuel my fire, lift me higher, burning brighter. Cause I let your words become my demons. I let you win, but now fuck it all, baby. Fuel my fire, lift me higher. Try to make me ashamed. Well, I know how to play it. Cause I don't give a shit what they all say about me. I don't let it get me down. I'm living my life every minute I'm alive. Maybe you should try it. I'm still growing now. I know when you say anything to bring me down. Fuck it all, baby. Throw it all. It all, baby. Feel my fire, lift me higher. Oh, one thing is for sure. Imagine that this Purim, we can be our own heroes. No matter how much they try to bring us down. Oh, fuck it all, baby. Throw it all. Brighter, cause I let your words become my demons. I let you win, but now I fuck it all, baby. Fuel my fire, burning brighter. Oh, oh, oh. That's it.
Thank you so much, Toby. That was amazing. Due to the wonders of live internet, Toby at one point during that song transcended and became an actual rainbow, which feels very Purim-y. And the sound was great, so I decided not to interrupt. And that was beautiful. What an absolute bop. This has been a night of incredible songs, and we've got two more coming up for you. The next writer is in what was apparently yesterday snowy Brooklyn and is now rainy and slushy Brooklyn. He's been at a few signals, and it's been one of those writers I knew but didn't think I'd be able to work with in the near future, but then suddenly the internet gave us the opportunity, and he's done a load of concerts and is brilliant, and is rocking a unique instrument for tonight, which is something that we always like to see. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce Julian Hornik. Hey, Julian.
Hello.
How you doing?
Oh, you know, just sitting in Brooklyn in the pandemic with a banjo. So just your average Purim.
How are you celebrating this Purim, or do you have any good Purim stories?
You know, I mean, mostly it just brings to mind like being in the Walnut Creek JCC as a kindergartner with like a grogger and being excited to get to wear like a princess dress to school.
Earlier today someone was like, you know, that thing, the thing that makes the noise, it's like a shaker, a rattle, and it's called a grogger. Julian knew.
I'm earning some serious Jew points remembering that it was called a grogger. Now the holiday mostly means to me hunting down vegan hamantaschen, which I feel like Brooklyn can probably provide.
I can imagine so. Tell us about the song.
Oh yeah, so this is a song called Dive, and it's kind of a standalone song that I wrote pretty soon after moving to New York, after graduating from college. And I had been on a job that I got right out of college. I'd been reading a bunch of material about potential film ideas for this director, and one idea that she got was about this German U-boat, the submarine that sunk in World War II, and trying to find a story around that. And then she never really glommed onto it, so I kind of took it and couldn't figure out the story until I decided that, oh, actually it's a song, and the story is that it's a German U-boat in World War II that is sunk by two German soldiers that started hooking up in the boat. And so for all their gayness, they decide, for the sake of their love, to assist the other side and take the ship down. So that's the song. And then obviously it had to be on banjo. So
obviously. Amazing. Yeah. Well, take it away. Thank you so much, Julia.
Cool. Of course, thank you.
I'm not a soldier. A sailor, I'm a barely ranking man. I'm not an engineer. I can only do the things, the few things that I can. And I can dive a thousand depths just to be with you. And I can dive.
On the floor, and we will let
It's crushing me, it's crushing. I will dive a thousand depths just to be with you. I will dive a thousand depths just to be with you. Just to be with you.
Thank you, Julian. Amazing. All right, on to our final act, which is a pretty special act. But before that, I want to say some thank yous. This was the brainchild of the amazing Deborah Vogt at JW3, who said, could we bring together Signal, which is, as I said, a new musical theatre concert with JW3. And it's been so inspiring for me to kind of like get to dig in a little bit more to the Jewish writing scene and the heritage. Obviously, when you think of like canonical classic musical theatre, the Jewish artists are kind of like very much embedded in that time. But I think that's kind of less and less common in musical theatre. So like drawing together artists with some sense of Jewish identity is kind of interesting, certainly interesting for me, and like what a lineup. So a big thank you to Deborah, a big thank you to the team at JW3, Daniel on tech, their end, and in the back of all of this, pulling this together live, are two incredible supporters and technical wizards, Matt Powell, I don't know why I said Matthew, and Christian Shawnee, kind of putting things together. So our next writers are in Boston and in LA, and I should say that just before I came on stage to do this final link, there was just a few issues on the back end, which we're trying to resolve, it shouldn't take more than a couple of minutes. But because I'm presenting the show and teching the show, there's sort of not really anywhere for me to go except to be here, and I don't quite know what to do with the dead air. So I don't know. First of all, I'm just gonna sit here for a little bit, and I'm just gonna breathe, because just wanna make sure that we deliver the finale as we should. But I would also just quickly say that if any of you want to write in the chat what Purim means to you and what you might do, then now's a good time. And I'm just gonna do a little bit of tech stuff, but I'll be here with you, and hopefully you'll be here with me. At some point, if we've got another couple of minutes, I'll play the harmonica, which I was hoping I wouldn't have to do again, but is something I do when time needs to be done. Yeah. I'll play the harmonica for a bit because it's Purim, and why not? Here is my case of harmonicas. And I'm just gonna... So something really funny just happened. I just got a text message saying that it's sorted. But I don't want to keep you in the lurch, so I'm just gonna play a little bit of Purim harmonica for you. All right, thanks for bearing with me and us. I hope you enjoyed. It gives me great pleasure to take you to, no big deal, but the creator of Transparent and their sister, who are going to talk to us about the show, the musical episode of the show, and the musical that they are writing. It gives me great pleasure to take you to LA and Boston and Joey and Faith Soloway. Hello, we did it.
Yay. We did it.
Yay.
I mean,
hello.
People should know that, that doing anything at this in this time period is much more difficult. So it's worth showing people there's a little cost to this stuff, but thank you for bearing with. Joey, why don't you kick us off? I'm a huge fan of Transparent. I don't know anyone who isn't, but obviously the last episode of it was a musical. And not only that, the show is really Jewish. So I don't know, it feels like Judaism and musical theater intersect for you. And I just wondered if you minded talking about that.
Yeah, I was just going for a hike behind my house this morning, and I hiked up to what Faith and I now fondly call Joyacost Mountain, which is where we shot the final scene there of everybody dancing in the woods. And it's actually in Griffith Park right behind my house. And I think our cinematographer, Jim Frona, said at some point, he said, oh, the whole reason we made this movie was so that we could make Joyacost. And I really feel like that's true. There's so much about just the idea of pain, trying to turn pain into pleasure in our bodies and in our everyday lives as Jews, that just felt, as Faith said, like that it needed to be like an Irish drinking song to just trying to be happy in the face of so much neurotic pain. So that felt like a healing from everything that happened with Transparent, the show, you know, the four seasons where after that we went through this reckoning as a community. That felt like a healing. And I feel like, you know, what Faith is working on now for the future is the future. I just can't wait to share it with the world.
We can't wait either. So Faith, you've been writing songs, I think you said, as long as you can remember.
Yes.
To talk about writing songs and yours and Joey's world intersecting.
I mean, that's my artistic language. That's how I feel and see and understand the world. And very early on when we were working on the first season of Transparent, I was seeing it as a musical way back, like 2013. And so was looking for songs and kind of kept that going, and we were able to pop them in here. But yes, and I started playing piano when I was, I think, five, and just never strayed from it. I was a musical director at Second City in college. I was always behind the piano with my friends. I've always in both worlds, comedy and music, serious musician, funny musician, folk musician here in Boston. And that's where I live. And yeah, Joey and I, when we were younger, would pretend to be in musicals, and our parents would have soundtracks of whatever the musical was in the 70s, actually, Jesus Christ Superstar, Fiddler on the Roof, all of those epic musicals that we grew up to. Those were the soundtrack, you know.
It's funny because I sometimes think in England that like musical theater is its like own bubble, and it doesn't always feel connected to the world of music or the world of television or the world of storytelling. But I often see in America that those things feel so blurred together, and especially like seeing the shows and the episode that you two made. And I just wondered if how you feel about like musical theater as something that you grew up with, or just something holistic in a way.
I mean, I always feel like I'm in a musical. That's just my weird brain. But it's funny, when you're in the comedy world, which I was in for a long time and still am, sometimes musicals are made fun of. You have to almost come out as a musical fan. Do you know what I'm saying?
I definitely know what you're saying.
Yeah. if you like musicals, you're a nerd. But I think we're all embracing that right now. Maybe we just need musicals more and more. Even in the television genre, we're seeing musicals as storytelling, you know. In the past 5 years, we're seeing a lot of musicals on television, here in America anyway.
Yeah, everybody has their musical episode. It's a normal, I think, rite of passage for every television show to have their musical episode. And then there's like Crazy Ex-Girlfriend.
Right. What's the one that's on right now that's actually songs that exist, but somebody's playlist, Zoe's playlist?
Oh, uh-huh. Those are musical numbers?
Yeah. I mean, they're existing songs, I think, but
got it.
They burst into... Did
you know with Transparent that you were heading towards that musical episode in some part of you? Or did it surprise you?
I mean,
yeah.
I think when actually one of the things that Faith forgot to mention was that actually when my parent first came out, we began making a documentary musical about the experience of having a trans parent. We immediately just started filming as our way to cope and worked with an amazing cinematographer, Kristen Johnson. She made Dick Johnson Is Dead. And remember, Faith, we really documented our life for that first year, and we wrote songs and performed them, and Faith performed them. And we were able to raise a little bit of money around the idea of it. And ultimately, once the musical happened with Amazon, we started filming the behind the scenes. Remember, Faith, Jimmy was also filming us workshopping. So it's almost like, everything has always been a musical and we have always been filming it. And as Faith said, it's like, it's our way of processing reality. Faith's more so than mine. For me, it's like everything is always a TV show or everything is always a movie or everything is a story or everything is seen from, you know, through the camera.
I love the idea that you've always been writing this as a musical. You've always been experiencing it as a musical. And now you're writing it as a musical. Do you want to go in to talk about that?
Yeah, I mean, slowly but surely, I've been writing songs. Some of the songs that were in the finale might be making their way to a stage version, and some aren't. And we're still in progress, in process of it. And it's been a lifelong dream for me to have a show on some big stage, Broadway, London, you know, it always has been. And it just, unfortunately, those dreams don't die, even as old as I am. And so I'm just in it now. I'm lucky that we have people that are interested, you know, and want to see this through. And at some point when we come out of this pandemic, we will be hopefully on stage somewhere. It's been the good thing about this time is just been being able to write and sit with this for a while. So
how is it collaborating right, like, yeah, as it always is, I suppose, but you've got members of your fan club right here for when this makes it to the stage. How's it been collaborating like across the country during a pandemic? Has it been?
We just learned how to do it just like what we're doing right now. Everybody just figured it out. And I know they're doing we've done Zoom table reads, we've done Zoom presentations, Zoom rehearsals, Zoom record, you know, there's no other way to do it but this way right now. And it's I think just we're all the denial of what we are missing out on. This almost feels like, oh, this is the way life is going to be. I can't wait to get out of this, whatever this bubble is, because I actually think we're going to be unfreezing ourselves and feeling for the first time because we've just been so isolated.
Absolutely.
Odd reality, people.
Do you have any, since it's Purim, do you have any good Purim stories or any Purim recollections?
Joey, do you?
Hakova Shali, Shalosh Pinot,
Shalosh
Pinot, Hakova Shali. It's like Homatashin is like the three point hat, Haman, and masks. I think when I've been doing sort of my like modern take on Purim and working with the rabbis that I love, everybody's always talking that you can use it as a holiday where you are encouraged to put on a mask for a night and ask yourself about your shadow side. Not that I celebrate Purim this way. I will not be wearing a mask around the house, but if I did, I feel like it would be, you know, halachic.
So do you want to tell us about the song and you know a bit about the where it is in the show and anything you feel able to tell us about the show as it
sure
exists?
Thank you. I mean, who knows where, if I'll just be honest, if this song that you're going to hear right now will even be in the show. It's like a first draft of a song for Mora as she is reconciling with everything, integrating everything, and realizing that the house that she's been in for so long might be a place that she needs to get out of, the literal house, because of her trauma in it, how she lived in it, how she didn't live in it, how she hid in it, and tried to be a parent with all of this going on inside of her. So it's an attempt to find a good song for Mora, and maybe a good part of this will be the song, and maybe it will be a different song. So that's where it is. It's yeah.
Well, we're really pleased to hear something that is new, and that, like, I don't know, when we set up this concert, it was all about hearing stuff from writers that may or may not be in the finished product, but it's just about giving a space for new things. Joey, any other final reflections or setups for the song that we should know about?
No, I love it so much, and well, I think our parents are watching, mm-hmm. and it's really a song from, you know, Mappa to Mom, and Mappa to herself, and you know, to our families as we all start to transition. For me, you know, looking at the person who was Jill and looking at the past and becoming somebody new, it's like this song is just so true for all trans people, I think, looking back at your life before you transitioned.
That seems like a very good place to hear the song. Joey, thank you so much for joining us. And
of course.
We're gonna go to Faith and hear this incredible song, and thank you.
Oh, thank you.
I'm looking for a lullaby to calm the little one inside who snuck out of these windows every night and climbed back in without a fight. But I won't find it here tonight with 40 years of him in this house, 40 years of putting family first, 40 years of growing in the shade, glimpses and mirrors, low lights and computers, praying I would change. Did I hold on too long? I'm looking for an exit door as memories bury me alive. She didn't have a chance to grow. I stuffed her down inside. Dear Rose, it wasn't your fault passing this all to me. He unleashed on you, and to survive, you punished me. And we inherit the loop, we inherit the pain, and we make family in the house. All these years of putting everyone first. All these years I'm thrown against the rocks, still treading water, trying to find her. Where did she go? Rose had a daughter. Where did I hide her? In my house of mirrors, how will she grow? It's time to let her know I held on too long to him. How do I belong?
Thank you so much. That was extraordinary, and I'm shaken. Thank you so much for joining us, Jerry and Faith, and all of you in the audience. This is available to watch on repeat. So share the link. Share it with friends and family. I've just been so thrilled by this incredible lineup, and what a way to finish it off. I immediately want to go and rewatch Transparent, and especially the finale. Nothing more really to say than a huge thank you to the behind the scenes masters, to Christian Chorney and Matt Powell. Christian Chorney and I run a tech solutions company called Theatrical.Solutions that organizes live stream events and digital theater and hybrid events and all sorts of stuff. So if you need any of that, Theatrical.Solutions. If you want to check out what I do with my team, you can go to ALPmusicals.com. And you will see about the shows we have developed and are developing, a couple of which are still on demand at Southwark Playhouse for the next few days. I'm trying to think if there's anything more I need to say. No, I think that's probably everything. It's been such a pleasure. Our next event is going to be on March the 12th and is a Signal collaboration with the Lowry Theatre, and it's part of their Rewrites Festival. March the 12th. Other than that, keep an eye on our Twitter at ALP Musicals or at JW3 London. And if you're able to support, you'll see on the end card you can donate to this concert via JW3 at jw3.org.uk/support-us/donate. But you'll see it on the end card. And if you're able to make a contribution, we would very much appreciate it. Anyway, that is all from me and us. Happy Purim, however you celebrate, and till next time. Thank you so much. And we're on the end card.